Good afternoon, I'm Laura Tunstall. First to breaking news on the latest developments from today's National Cabinet meeting. There are major changes on COVID testing and isolation rules after leaders agree to an overhaul. Politics reporter Eliza Edwards is standing by in Canberra to bring us up to date. Eliza, talk us through the details of the changes.
Yeah, Laura, there's quite a lot of them. Despite mostly open borders, leaders were separated by screens again for today's snap National Cabinet meeting. There was a lot on the agenda, and states and territories have largely agreed on a major recalibration of our pandemic response. Let me take you through some of the key changes. So there's a new definition for a close contact. You only need to isolate if you live with someone who's COVID positive or you spent more than 4 hours with them in an accommodation or care setting. This new definition will come into effect in New South Wales, Victoria, Queensland, South Australia and the ACT from tonight, in Tasmania from January 1, and WA and the Northern Territory will make announcements in the coming days on how they'll move to the definition, noting they have fewer cases. There'll also be a major shake-up of testing and isolation requirements as we start to see high case numbers becoming the new norm. So if you are confirmed to be COVID positive, you will need to isolate for 7 days and return a negative rapid test on day 6. If you are a close contact who has symptoms, you must queue up and get a PCR test. But if you don't have symptoms, a rapid test will suffice, unless that's positive, in which case you do need to back it up with a PCR. And close contacts must isolate for 7 days as well from their date of exposure and get a rapid test on day 6 just to be sure. Here's the Prime Minister and Chief Medical Officer discussing the reason for these changes.
We cannot have hundreds of thousands of Australians and more taken out of circulation based on rules that were set for the Delta variant.
The other key element of this is we need to protect our PCR testing for where the best bang for the buck is.
So the Prime Minister says if you don't meet this new close contact definition, you don't need to go and get tested. He says this change is necessary and insists it gets the balance right as we enter a new phase of the pandemic. But it might take a little getting used to, Laura.
Thanks, Eliza, for all those details. Well, there's been another rise in COVID cases in New South Wales, despite a significant drop in testing. There are 12,226 new infections and one person has died. Just over 97,000 tests were done, a drop of about 60,000 on yesterday, but lines are still long at clinics across Sydney. Some people turned away are waiting for hours.
The rules are you need a COVID test, and I've been doing that, but then I refuse to sit in the car. I can't sit in the car for 5 hours at the moment. I had my chemo yesterday. I've got to go again on Tuesday for chemo, and I'm expected to line up tomorrow in this.
There are 746 people in hospital with COVID, up by more than 100 on yesterday. 63 are in intensive care. Testing times continue to blow out across Melbourne while a major pathology lab says it warned authorities sites would become overwhelmed. Reid Butler reports.
It's a frustrating waiting game.
I actually thought I was going to be the first one here, but obviously not.
But the real wait begins after you get tested. It can take as many as 6 days to find out whether you're positive or negative. All the while, you've been locked up in isolation. Now, one of the swamped pathology labs, Foresight, is claiming it sounded the alarm at the beginning of the month.
I wouldn't accept the premise that anyone's ignored any warnings. We had a situation where 40% of our testing capacity has been taken up by requirements set by two other states.
But Foresight's medical director says it told the Victorian government 3 weeks ago that those testing requirements for travel were going to create major problems.
We shouldn't be using PCR for domestic travel. It makes absolutely no sense.
Luckily, those states are now changing those rules. We did both increase the hours as well as the number of testing centres in order to try and cater for that.
It's a mess, and Victorians are the ones caught in the middle. To help prioritise the sick, the Albert Park testing site is telling drivers to turn on their hazard lights if they've already returned a positive rapid test. The site has hit capacity before opening every day for the past 2 weeks.
I was at the cricket for the first two days, so you know, I heard some cases there. To be sure, I guess.
And in the next few days, as Melbourne swelters through a heat wave, several testing sites will be closed for safety reasons. To check if that affects your local, head to the government's COVID website.
To breaking news out of Sydney now, where a fire has ripped through a boat shed at Drummoyne in the city's inner west. More than 50 firefighters were called in to bring the blaze under control. Earlier, thick black smoke was pouring into the air and the flames spreading to nearby balconies. Two people managed to escape uninjured. And here's a live shot from our rooftop camera of the fire. Smoke is still coming out from the boat shed. Authorities will now treat this as a hazmat incident. The fuels, oils, paint and electrics are all helping to fan those flames. There's been chaotic scenes from the nation's capital today. Fire has engulfed Old Parliament House in Canberra. Flames and thick black smoke billowing from the front of what was once Australia's democratic home. Protesters cheering, chanting and clashing with police. The fire causing extensive damage to the front of what is now a museum. Let's go live to Rachel Baxter, who's in Canberra. Rachel, what sparked this?
Well, Laura, it's understood a traditional smoking ceremony started this fire this morning, but take a look at this. It is just truly devastating. These are the famous steps of Old Parliament House, the steps that the Queen walked up on her first visit here to Australia in 1964. And you can see that the architraves and the front door there have been completely engulfed by fire. And if you take a look at some of these videos, you can see the smoking ceremony started just at the front of the building, and then wind or something started to push back the flames and completely engulf the front of the building. That's when police arrived. They must have been alerted by passerbys. There was a lot of people here today watching on, but you can just see how violent it started to get. Protesters pushing police, police retreating back in towards the building, trying to get away. We arrived here at around midday, and that's when protesters started turning their anger towards us. We had our cameras punched. We had one cameraman have water poured onto him, and surprisingly, there's been no arrests made and nobody has yet been charged, but we are waiting to hear from police just around the corner in a very short amount of time. This isn't the first fire here this week either, Laura. There was one last week, just a smaller fire after another smoking ceremony at the front doors here, and it's understood it's because in a couple of weeks' time, the Aboriginal embassy here will be having its 50th anniversary on Australia Day, although we have heard from the Aboriginal embassy and they have condemned this awful, awful tragedy.
Thanks very much for that, Rachel. British socialite Ghislaine Maxwell is facing up to 65 years behind bars after being found guilty of sex trafficking in a New York court. US correspondent Alison Petrowski has the details.
Ghislaine Maxwell was found guilty of the five of the six charges against her. The most serious charge, sex trafficking a minor, she was found guilty on that one. This charge solely related to one of the four women, a woman known only as Carolyn in court, who was 14 when she began to go to Jeffrey Epstein's home in Palm Beach, Florida, 2 to 3 times a week and perform sexualized massages on Epstein, all of which Maxwell facilitated. For this count alone, Ghislaine Maxwell faces up to 40 years in prison. The other guilty counts were 3 counts of conspiracy and also transporting a minor. Let's hear from US prosecutor Damian Williams.
A unanimous jury has found Ghislaine Maxwell guilty of one of the worst crimes imaginable, facilitating and participating in the sexual abuse of children. Crimes that she committed with her longtime partner and co-conspirator, Jeffrey Epstein.
Ghislaine Maxwell did not look at the jury as the verdict was read out. After the verdict, she calmly poured herself a glass of water. Here's her lawyer, Bobby Sternheim.
We firmly believe in Ghislaine's innocence. Obviously, we are very disappointed with the verdict. We have already started working on the appeal.
In total, Ghislaine Maxwell could face up to 65 years behind bars. That would essentially be the rest of her life. She turned 60 years of age on Christmas Day. That sentencing date is yet to be set.